So this is EE610, lecture 7. So one of the key things that we saw in the last class was that you cannot rely on the transistor parameters, the device parameters being a constant. These parameters such as mu and COX, VTH, etc. are going to vary from chip to chip, and even within the same chip it will vary with temperature, right? So now if you took a transistor and then biased this to a constant VGS0, ideally you would have expected to see a constant ID0 through this. This is of course connected to, it's not floating, it's connected to something, right? You would have expected to see a constant ID0 through it. But if your temperature changes and the VTH of this transistor increases, what happens to ID0? It will decrease, right? Similarly, if mu and COX changes, your ID0 is going to change, right? And then we saw that if your bias point is changing, then your GM is changing, gain is changing, input signal swing limit calculations are going to change, everything is going to change, right? So we figured out, instead of biasing with constant VGS0, let's say we figured out a way to bias with a constant current, then the properties we require, such as the gain, GM, etc., are less sensitive to device parameters. So instead of biasing with constant VGS0, we have now started biasing with a constant current. Right? Now to bias with a constant current, we will have to figure out a smart battery that is going to track any changes in the device parameters to ensure that the current through this is a constant. Right? And we now recognize that if I simply try to push a current IREF through a transistor, this doesn't guarantee that the current through the transistor is actually IREF. Right? The current through the transistor is going to be some ID. It's possible that the IREF is greater than ID. If IREF is greater than ID, what comment can you make about this node? The charge, the current entering this node is larger than the current leaving that node, right? Which means there could be charge accumulation there leading to an increase in potential. If you want to think about it directly in terms of the current, you can consider a small capacitor at that node. So the difference in the current is now either flowing into the capacitor or flowing out of the capacitor, right? So now if IREF is greater than ID, you have IREF minus ID, the difference flowing into the capacitor, resulting in this node potential Vx to increase, right? If your IREF was smaller than ID, the current entering the node is smaller than the current leaving the node, which means that excess current has to be pulled out of this capacitor. Therefore, the Vx potential is now going to reduce, right? And we also saw, corresponding to IREF greater than ID, we wanted to increase the gate potential so that the ID would increase, right? Similarly, when IREF was lesser than ID, we wanted to reduce the gate potential so that the ID would reduce. And we can achieve this by simply shorting the gate and the drain together. Okay? So we are sensing or measuring the current at the drain and feeding it back to the gate. And this is called as drain feedback. Okay? And what would be the potential generated here? Let me call this as VGS0. What is the value? This will be equal to VG, I agree, right? VG, but can you comment on what that potential would be? So now, once you make this connection, you are guaranteed that the current through the transistor is also IREF. If an IREF current is flowing through the transistor, and you know that a corresponding VGS0 has been developed to sustain this IREF, what comment can you make about that voltage VGS0? This will be equal to the threshold voltage plus square root of 2ID by mu n COX W by L. Right? This is of course assuming that the transistor is in saturation region. Okay, now we wanted to connect this to our amplifier. So we have an amplifier here. Right, we wanted to bias this node at VGS0, and we said that we could use the mechanism we just discussed and connect the circuit lines. Right, this would ensure that if this node is seeing a VGS0 where a current IRF is being pushed through this, the same VGS0 is applied to the second transistor, resulting in a current IRF flowing through this, provided the mu n COx, W by L and VTH of these transistors are same, right? And we said that on the same die, you can ensure that two transistors have identical parameters. So the mu n COx, VTH, etc. of both the transistors will be same. Now the W by L is under the control of the designer. So if you give, let's say, some W by L here, you ensure that the same W by L is given to the second transistor also, then the same current IRF is going to flow through this. Okay. Then we wanted to connect our small signal source. We connected the small signal source like this. Right? And after we connected the small signal source like this, we quickly calculated the operating point and the incremental voltages. Say this is RS, we have C1 and this is C2. So when we calculated the, when we drew the circuit for the operating point, you will have IRF here. The capacitor will be open. Therefore, RS is not going to be connected to this node. What happens to the incremental VS in the operating point circuit? It is connected to short circuited. Therefore, this is zero. So it's connected to the second transistor. We have RL1. This capacitor is open. So you simply have RL here. Let me call this transistor as M1. This is M2. Quickly, let's go over the potentials again. What is the operating point potential here? 0 volt, correct. Here? This is 0 volt. Let's say that this was VDD. What is the potential here? Some VGS0. What is the value of VGS0 again? VTH plus square root of 2ID by mu n COx W by L. Potential here? VDD minus IRF into RL, right? So now you are very confident with calculating the operating point voltage. Also the current through this has to be IRF. Okay. Then we also did the incremental circuit for this. What happens to IRF? In the incremental circuit, what happens to the, it gets open circuit. The current through this transistor is going to be GM times whatever is the voltage appearing across its gate. I'm assuming that the capacitor is large enough such that it is a short at the input frequency. You have RS, VS. So again, if this is some potential Vx, the VGS1 for this transistor is simply Vx. Therefore, current flowing through this will be GM times Vx. I can change this also to GM times Vx. And this is then connected to the load RL parallel RL1. So now in calculating the gain, the first step would be to calculate what is Vx, right? And how did we say we could replace this whole circuit? It can be replaced by a resistor of value 1 by Gm. Right? Then the expression for Vx is? Into Rs. So, we want to find out the potential here, right? The circuit is same as Vs, Rs, 1 by Gm. Right? So, this becomes Vs into 1 by Gm divided by Rs plus 1 by Gm. And we said that this factor is expected to be smaller than 1, which means your Vx value is now going to be smaller than Vs. This is something that we want to avoid, right? And what is our solution? We want to add some component in this path, right? Such that in the ideal operating point calculation, that component does not cause any difference in your operating point potentials, right? So the component can be present here, but it shouldn't change any of our operating point potentials by a large amount. And in the incremental picture, this component is now appearing here. That should offer a large impedance such that it becomes 1 by Gm plus something. And in the denominator also you have 1 by Gm plus something, right? So now if this component is offering a large impedance, right, then most of the Vs is going to drop across this portion. So instead of just being 1 by Gm, this is now some component in series with 1 by Gm. And we want this component to have a very large impedance such that all of the Vs is now going to appear here. Okay. Now what component do you think we can put here? We could put a resistor. Before you think about a resistor, is there a different component that you would want to consider? Inductor also, right? Because in DC, inductor is going to be a short, which means your operating point is going to remain as it is. And you just have to make sure that the impedance of the inductor at the frequency of interest, which is omega n times L, is much, much larger than Rs. Right? It has to be much, much larger than this resistor. Right? If you ensure this, then all of your Vs is going to drop across the gate source voltage of the transistor. Okay? Now, thing is, inductors are slightly difficult to fabricate on chip. Therefore, we use a poor man's inductor, which is a very large resistor for the time being. So, instead of an inductor, we put in a very large resistor, let's say Rx. Now, if you put a large resistor Rx, what do you think will happen to the operating point calculation? So, you have current IRF flowing like this. What is the current flowing through M1? This is IRF, right? What is the current flowing into the gate of this node? Zero. What is the current flowing here? Zero, right? Then what do you think is the current flowing to this node? Zero. So the current across Rx is going to be zero. No current is flowing through Rx. Therefore, there is no potential drop across Rx. Therefore, all the operating point VGS is going to remain as it is. So introducing a large Rx is not changing our operating point at all. Okay? Now, in the incremental circuit, you will have a large Rx here, therefore the division, voltage division will now look like this. Okay. Now if your Rx is much, much larger than Rs, then your Vx will be almost equal to Vs. Okay. So, if Vx is almost equal to Vs. I can replace this as Vs. Right? Now, can you quickly tell me the gain? What would be the gain? So, this is your Vout. You have Vs here. I am interested in Vout divided by the source, incremental source voltage. This will be given by minus Gm times RL parallel RF. Right, so we have now calculated the gain. What is the next thing that we should do? We assume that both C1 and C2 are short at the frequency of interest. Now we have to identify what, so we said that C1 is large enough so that it can be considered as a short at the frequency of interest. C2 is large enough such that it is a short at the frequency of interest. Now we have to define what is meant by large, right? How do we do that? The idea is very simple. The incremental circuit is a linear network, right? So you have some linear network. We pull out two nodes of this linear network and we know that there is some capacitor connected between the two. Let's say this is your C1, right? Which means if this was a linear network, which means I can replace it by its Thevenin equivalent. So, it's a voltage source followed by a resistor, some R Thevenin. And we have a capacitor connected across these two nodes, right? I'm simply going to call this as node A, this is node B. So, in this circuit, right, this is your node A. This is your node B, right? Now, of course, we are going to do the analysis in the incremental circuit. So, I will directly add your capacitor into this picture. You are looking at node A and node B. Is this clear what I have done? I am saying that you have a very linear network. I pull out this capacitor C1 outside, so I have some component C1 connected between node A and node B. And the rest of the whole thing, I consider it as some linear network. So that is same as saying I have a picture like this, and I replace this whole linear network by its Thevenin equivalent. Right? Then I can calculate what is RTH, and if required, I could also calculate what is VTH. Right? Now, what is our ultimate aim? What should be the potential drop across this? Vc has to tend to 0, right? If Vc has to tend to 0, what comment can you make about the impedance offered by C1 with respect to the impedance offered by RTH? It has to be very small, right? So, the condition is 1 by omega n times C1 has to be much, much smaller than RTH. So, you find out the nodes A and B in your circuit of interest, identify the rest of the linear network, you calculate what is RTH for you. Once you find out the Thevenin resistance between the nodes A and B, you simply make sure that that Thevenin resistance is much, much higher than the impedance offered by C1 at the frequency of interest. Okay? So, we have done this calculation once. So, I will leave it as a homework for you to calculate the limits on C1 and C2. Okay. So, capacitor values is done. What is the next point that we should discuss? Swing limits, right? So, now the circuit we have is a little bit more interesting than a circuit with one boring transistor. We have two transistors, which means we have to analyze both during the swing limit calculation. Right? So let me bring up the circuit. Okay. So we'll do this analysis as before for positive input cycle and for negative input cycle. We said this was transistor M1, this is transistor M2. Now, during positive input cycle, what comments can you make about M1? The total VGS of M1 is increasing, decreasing, remaining same. Increasing, right? Because the total VGS is going to be whatever is your bias voltage plus some A times sine of omega in T. And we are talking about the positive cycle, which means we consider this factor to be a positive number. So your total VGS is increasing. So total VGS for M1 is increasing. What about the total VDS? Total VDS. So we are looking at M1 transistor. This is our transistor. This is?
Decreases.
Increases. The gate and the drain are shorted. It increases. Right? And what comment can you make about the ID? Gate is increasing, drain is increasing. ID remains constant. Everybody agrees that ID remains constant. Is there a different opinion? Correct, right? So you are guaranteed that this current is IRF. Right? If your gate voltage is changing, you can have a small signal current here. So the current through the transistor is going to be IRF plus a small signal drain current. Is that clear? So when your gate voltage is increasing, that means I would expect to see a small signal ID. I think the confusion now is, where is the small signal ID coming from? Is that the confusion? So this small signal ID has to come like this. So in your incremental circuit, you can have a small signal ID flowing like this. And your 1 by GM, you got 1 by GM here because you had this circuit. So you cannot of course have a current flowing like this, which means the current is flowing like this. In the incremental circuit, there would be a voltage drop across RS, right? And that is what we discussed here. So you can expect to see some current flowing like this, right? You can expect to see a drain current flowing like this, which will result in a voltage drop across RS and another voltage drop across this RX plus 1 by GM. And we want to make sure the voltage drop across RX plus 1 by GM is, which we called as VX, is mostly equal to VS. So we wanted the voltage drop here, let me call this as VRS, to be very, very small, and the voltage drop across this VX to be very, very large. Is that okay? So your total drain current is going to increase. Right? Now, is there a danger of M1 entering into any other region other than saturation? So can this enter into triode region? Yes? No? Right? It cannot enter into triode region because under all possible circumstances, your VDS is equal to VGS, right? And what is our condition for a device to be in saturation region? Your VDS has to be greater than VGS minus VTH. So your VDS is already equal to VGS, so you don't even have to worry about this factor. So under all possible circumstances, during the positive input cycle, M1 will remain in saturation. Which means for swing limit calculations during the positive cycle, I don't have to worry about M1. It is guaranteed to remain in saturation. Now, what about M2? Positive input cycle, the source voltage VS is increasing. What happens to VGS? VS is increasing. What happens to the voltage here? What is the confusion now? What happens to the incremental voltage here? Okay, so in the incremental circuit, right, if VS increases, so I will again assume that we have correctly put a capacitor value, right? If I increase VS, what happens to VX? Both are similar, right? So that will also increase. Therefore, your total gate-to-source voltage is now going to increase. Your total gate-to-source voltage is the voltage provided by that intelligent smart battery, VGS0, which we expect will not change, plus VX, which we expect is now going to follow VS. So in M2, when your VS is increasing, your VGS is going to increase. What happens to the drain current? Increases. What happens to VDS? Increases. VDS is going to go down. Right? Why? What is the expression? So this is going to be VDD minus IRF into RL1. This will remain constant, minus GM times RL1 parallel RL. Right? Now RL1 parallel RL into VS. Right? So we are considering the positive input cycle. If I assume that the maximum amplitude VS can take is A, then this is simply A. Right? So your VDS is going to reduce. Which means into what region can your M2 possibly go? It could enter triode region. Right? So your M2 can enter triode region. Which means for calculation of the swing limits, you will put in the conditions for the triode region, saturation region limit. So you will put in the condition that your total VDS has to be greater than total VGS minus VTH. You now know what all of these values are. Put those in and you will get a limit for the input signal magnitude A. Okay. Now let us look at, so this is something that we have done already. There isn't any change in the way how we are calculating. So if you have any questions, I can redo this, otherwise we'll move on. Okay. So then let's look at the negative input cycle. First, you can tell me what happens to M2. Right? So you have a negative input cycle. That means your VS value is now reducing. It is negative in nature. What happens to VGS? VGS of M2 decreases. Good. So VGS of M2 is reducing. What happens to VDS? Why is VDS reducing? We are looking at M2. It increases, right? Yeah. So VDS is increasing. And what happens to ID? VGS reduces, the ID has to reduce, right? So you simply check for the condition that the total ID has to be greater than 0 and this gives you the limit where your M2 transistor can enter into cutoff. Okay. What about M1? My VS is reducing. So my VS is reducing. Quickly tell me what happens to the VGS of M1. VGS1 reduces. What happens to the drain current? Total drain current also reduces. Is there a confusion there? So if your VS is negative, the voltage appearing here, the incremental voltage appearing here is negative, that means your small signal ID is now going to flow out like this. Which means IRF plus ID, which is your total current through M1, is now going to reduce. Because the ID is flowing in the opposite direction. So I should write it as IRF minus ID. Right? IRF is flowing from drain to source. Your incremental current is flowing in the opposite direction. Okay? So your ID is reducing. And of course, you would expect your VDS also to reduce. Right? Which means M1 can also enter. What region can it enter? It can also enter cutoff. Right? So we have analyzed this very theoretically. We could proceed by putting in the condition for M1 also. Right? ID has to be greater than 0. But given what you know now, is there a simplification we can make? During the negative input cycle, do we need to analyze for both M1 and M2, or is there a simplification you can make based on the circuit you have in front of you? Feel free to discuss and then let me know. So I'm interested in the negative input cycle, right? During the negative input cycle, do I have to check separately the value of input where M1 is entering into cutoff, value of input where M2 is entering into cutoff, and then figure out what is the ultimate maximum value that I can give? Or is there a simplification that you can do now? Small signal is much less compared to the operating point, but that is a simplification we always make. Right? Nothing very specific to this case. Drain or gate are connected, I agree to that, right? But it can still enter into cutoff region. If the device is on, then it is in saturation, right? But the device could also be in cutoff. If your VGS reduces, right? If your VGS is not greater than VTH, right? The device could enter into cutoff region. So if it is on, you are guaranteed it is in saturation, but you first have to make sure it is on. That's between M1 and M2, which transistor do you think is going to enter into cutoff first? M1. Why M1? Incremental voltage, that point is correct, right? The incremental voltage you see at the gate of M1, right? It is smaller than the incremental voltage you see at the gate of M2. So in the incremental circuit, right? Which point in the circuit is connected to the gate of M1? So this is Rx. This point is connected to the gate of M2. This is your amplifying transistor. Right? Where is this point taken from? This is between Rx and 1 by GM, right? So I'll simply call this as your VG1, right? This is connected to the gate of M1. Which of them is greater, Vx or VG1? Vx is definitely greater, right? We would expect Vx to be much, much greater than VG1, right? So when you apply an incremental voltage of the form A sine of omega in t, right, you expect to see A here and you expect to see a very small value here as VG1. VG1 is going to be much, much smaller than A. Right? So when your current, when your total VGS for M2 is reducing, that is going to reduce at a much faster rate than the total gate voltage of M1. Because the incremental voltage appearing at the gate of M1 is smaller. Is that clear? The signal swings seen by M1 is much smaller than the signal swings seen by M2. Any questions on that? So if signal swing seen by M2 is larger, right, which of these devices will enter into cutoff first? M2 will enter cutoff first, right? So you simply need to find out the signal swing limit for M2, and you make sure that that condition is satisfied, then this automatically guarantees that M1 will never enter into cutoff. So even though you have two transistors to analyze, right, if you are, you know, just take one look at it and you recognize that during positive input cycle, your M1 is always in saturation and only M2 can enter into triode region. So for positive input cycle, it is sufficient if you analyze only for M2. Right? You calculate and you will get some Amax1. Now for negative input cycles, though both of them can potentially enter into cutoff, your M2 transistor is going to enter cutoff first. Simply because it sees much larger signal swings than M1. So here also it is sufficient if you analyze only for M2. Right? Analyze only for M2 and then you will find out what is the Amax2. Then you determine which of them, figure out which is minimum, and that is the ultimate input signal swing limit you can apply here. Is that okay? Now, this sort of analysis is going to happen over and over. You might have 10 transistors and theoretically you are supposed to check whether each of those transistors are remaining in the correct region of operation. But if you take one look at it and, you know, look at how the signal swings are, you will be able to figure out that you actually need to do the analysis only for 3-4 transistors. If you meet the condition for those 3-4 transistors, the others will be automatically met. So the with a little bit of intuition like this, you can simplify your life a lot. Okay, so take a minute and see if you have any questions on this. Okay, so now if you were doing this on IC, perfect, you have to use two transistors, but you have figured out a way to develop a smart battery giving you VGS0, and you use this battery to bias the second transistor which will act as your amplifier. Right? Now imagine you were not doing this on a single IC, you were purchasing discrete transistors from a shop and you are putting this onto a breadboard to make your circuit, much like how you are figuring out things in ESC201 lab. Right? Then what happens? Does this theory work? Why not? So the problem is, we said that if you have transistors in two separate chips, there is no guarantee that your VTH is going to be same, their mu and Cox is going to be same, right? On the same chip, to a large extent, you can ensure that they have similar properties. Two different chips, totally out of your control, right? Unless they specifically say that they have put in additional features to make it safe, which is very rare, right? So if you have two different chips, nominally they might have the same VTH. But under different circumstances, one's VTH might go up, the others might go down, and of course your bias current is not what you wanted. Okay? Now here is the question. I have generated VGS0 using a transistor. Okay? And I have used another transistor to amplify. Could I have done both these tasks using the same transistor? Question is clear? I use one single transistor to generate the bias voltage, and I provide the signal to be amplified to the same transistor and I expect to see an output. So what we need to do is this. We have to build a circuit such that in the operating point, the circuit looks like this. Right? And it develops a corresponding VGS naught here, and in the incremental circuit I want to see something like this. So you have some RS, VS, and the current, incremental current, has to flow through some load. Now, of course, we intuitively understand that we are okay even if there is an additional resistor here. We just have to make sure that that RX is much, much greater than RS. Similarly, you could have other things parallel with your RL and we should still be fine, right? So now we are interested in combining both of these to build our next circuit, right? So let us attempt this. I'll first sketch out the operating point circuit as it is. Then we'll see if we can connect our incremental sources to this. Okay. So this is IRF. How should I connect the incremental voltage source? Where should I connect it? I should connect it to the gate, right? And how should I connect this? I should use a capacitor so that the DC operating point is not affected. So I use some capacitor C1. RS and VS. What should I do at the output? I need to connect a load resistor, right? So I connect it through C2 and I put in some RL here. Is this correct? The operating point circuit, the large signal circuit, does it look identical? Operating point wise, we are fine, right? What happens in the incremental circuit? So now you have a short between these two. Okay? That's not what we want, right? It is going to cause a problem. So I could think of adding some component in this path. This path is a problem, right? So I could add some component in this path, which will act as a short in the large signal circuit, and it should act as an open circuit in the incremental circuit, right? So it should be a short in this image and it should be an open circuit in this image. What can I add? Inductor, right? If I add an inductor here, what happens? In the DC, it is short. In the operating point, the inductor's impedance is given by omega into frequency of operation into inductance. For DC, omega is zero. Therefore, it is a clean short, right? So you have this picture. Now, in the incremental circuit, I simply have to make sure that omega in L is a very large impedance. At the frequency of your input source, which is omega n, we want this to be an open circuit. Then you will get to this picture. This is okay? Very nice, right? Using a single transistor, we have been able to achieve generation of the bias voltage as well as amplification. Well, the only problem is realizing large inductors is not very easy. So if we can avoid using a large inductor, we would like to do that, right? So now we have to think of a different component that needs to be replaced here. So with the inductor, the circuit is correct, but if possible, we would like to replace the inductor. That's all. What else can I put here? I could put a large resistor. Very good. Right? Now I can put a large resistor here. So now in the large signal picture, I now have a very large resistor connected here. Right? What happens in the bias voltage generation? How does my VGS not change? It doesn't change, right? What is the current flowing in here? Zero. Therefore, no current is flowing in this path. All of your IRF is still flowing through your transistor. Therefore, the VGS0 remains the same, right? So even though you have an RX present in your large signal circuit, it is not affecting your operating points. Now, in the small signal circuit, you would have, now we have connected an RX here. And our hope is, if your RX is very, very large, right? This is very, very large, then it sort of acts like an open circuit. Now, if you make such a statement, we have to figure out how large our Rx should be, right? And it turns out if you simply calculate what the gain is from your input to the output, you look at the gain expression, and then you can figure out how large your Rx should be such that your gain doesn't change a lot from what is the, from the ideal expected value. So that is what we are going to do next. So this is the circuit you have. This is Vout. I am going to call this node as VGS. What is the current flowing through the transistor? This is your incremental circuit, right? GMVGS. So the current flowing through this transistor is GM times VGS. Can you calculate Vout by VS? So please give it a go. So I can apply KCL at this node. You can have a current flowing like this, another current flowing like this, and there is no current flowing into the gate. So there are two currents that I need to manage in the KCL equation. So I basically have VGS minus VS by RS, but instead of writing it as 1 by RS, I'll simply write it as GS. This plus VGS minus Vout into GX should be equal to 0. Right? So now I am going to write it in a particular format. There are two nodes for which the voltages are not known, VGS and Vout. Right? So I am going to write it in this format. So there is VGS, some factor associated with it, plus some factor associated with Vout, this will be equal to something. Okay. Now, with respect to VGS, I have GS plus GX. For Vout, what do I have? Minus GX. Right? And this should be equal to the input into GS. Now at Vout node, there are three possible currents. You have one current flowing in this direction, another current flowing in this direction, plus GMVGS. So this gives you Vout minus VGS into GX plus GMVGS plus Vout into GL should be equal to 0. I again write it in this format in terms of Vout and VGS. So for VGS, you have GM from here and minus GX from here. And for Vout, what do you get? You have GX plus GL. And this should be equal to 0. Okay. Once you write it in this format, you can make this into a matrix where your variables of interest are VGS and Vout. And this is equal to VSGS and 0. So I obtained this matrix based on the two equations. This was your first equation. This is your second equation. Okay. Now to find out Vout, I can directly apply Cramer's rule. Vout will be equal to, tell me the denominator first. Into GX plus GL minus plus GX into GM minus GX. To calculate the numerator, you have to replace this column with VSGS and 0 and then take the determinant. What do you get? minus Vs Gs into Gm minus I can simplify this a little bit. So your gain given by V out by Vs is minus Gs into Gm minus Gx divided by Gs Gx plus Gx square plus Gx GL plus Gm Gx minus Gx square. And once you simplify, you see that there are two gx squares with opposite polarity, so they get cancelled out, right? So we have a very, very simple equation to deal with. Are we missing a term? Are we missing a term in the denominator?
Yes.
So, you are missing the GSGL term. A very simplified expression. Okay. So, just by looking at it, it's not very obvious how your GX or your RX should behave, right? So, now what I'm going to do is we are going to tease out the relationships we want from this equation. So, one thing we know is that your V out by Vs is expected to be minus GMRL, right? Minus GMRL, or in other words, it is expected to be minus GM by GL, right? So, I'm going to bring out minus GM by GL upfront. So, you have the negative sign here. I'll bring out GM from the numerator. So, this gives me GS into 1 minus GX by GM. Right, and then I will bring out GL from the denominator. So what does this give you? You have GS GX by GL plus GX plus GM GX by GL plus GS. And I see that GS is common in these two terms, right? So I could simplify this a little bit by bringing them closer together. What will I get? So you'll get GS into 1 plus GX by GL, right? And in the remaining two terms, what is common? Gx is common. So, I could bring that out. So, this is going to give you Gx into 1 plus Gm by Gl. Okay. So, this is the ideal gain that we want. Right? If that is the ideal gain, what comment can you make about this big factor? We want this to be equal to 1. But this is still a little complicated to analyze it just by looking at it. So, I'm going to make one more assumption. What comment can you make about the ideal value of the source resistance, RS? Right? If you had a choice, you would have liked your RS to be equal to 0. Right? RS equal to 0 means that your GS is equal to infinity. Right? Now, apply that into this equation and tell me how your gain is changing. This becomes minus Gm by Gl, right? You divide numerator and denominator by Gs. So, once you do that, you will simply have Gs in the last term, right? Gs goes to infinity. This last term is going to 0, right? The other factors will remain there as it is. So, you get 1 minus Gx by Gm divided by 1 plus Gx by Gm. Okay. Now the equation is looking much more tame, right? It is looking like we'll be able to handle this. Now, if you want this value to be equal to minus Gm by Gl, what are the conditions you can tell me? Make Okay, so gx equal to 0, what does it mean? Rx has to go to infinity, right? We sort of expected this, right? Why did we expect this? We wanted in the incremental circuit, this Rx to result in an open circuit. So Rx tending to infinity is what we would get from our intuition directly, right? Now let's get a little bit more, focused on what the upper limit of Rx should be. Sorry, what the lower limit of Rx should be. Getting an infinite resistance is not possible, right? We talk about getting a large resistance. So now we are discussing how large should Rx be. If possible, infinity. If you are able to discover an infinite resistance, very good, right? But if infinite resistance is possible, it is not possible, what is the next best thing? We make it as large as possible. So then the question is, how large should Rx be? Now looking at this, can you give me the conditions? If we want this to be equal to minus gm by gl, we will want the numerator, this factor, to be equal to 1, right? And the denominator to also be equal to 1. How can we achieve this? So this would mean that your gx by gm is much, much smaller than 1, right? Equal to 0, same as saying I want Rx to be infinity, right? So we say Gx by Gm should be much, much smaller than 1. We also want Gx by Gl to be much, much smaller than 1, right? If both of these conditions are satisfied, then you get the ideal gain that you wanted. So now you have two conditions in front of you. Can you tell me which of these conditions will be the limiting factor? Minimum of half, but what do you think will be the limiting factor? If we wanted a large gain, right, we would try to make sure our GM is large and our RL is large, right? RL being large means that your GL is small, right? Now, can you look at this and tell me which of these is going to be the limiting factor? GX by GL, right? So this condition will be the limiting factor. Typically, need not be the case, could vary from circuit to circuit. But under most conditions, you will see that the condition of making Gx to be much, much smaller than Gl is most likely going to be the limiting factor. And this corresponds to making sure that Rx is much, much larger than R. Is that okay? So we started off with a very complicated equation. We couldn't make head or tails of it, but now we have figured out how to analyze it to understand what the conditions on Rx should be. So now in this, we made an assumption that Rs is tending to 0 or your source resistance is tending to 0. Now if you had finite source resistance, then how would we analyze this? Okay. Assume that you had a finite Gs, your Gs was not tending to infinity, then how would you analyze this? Right? We make use of the assumptions that we have already figured out, right? Let's assume that your Gx by Gm is much, much smaller than 1 and your Gx by Gl is also much, much smaller than 1, right? Then you will get minus gm by gl into 1 by 1 plus gx by gs into what approximation can I make here? Should I write this as 1 or something else? Gm by gl, do you expect gm by gl to be much, much greater than 1 or much, much smaller than 1? Much, much greater than 1, right? Gm by gl is your gain. So you could ignore 1 with respect to that. So you can write this as gm by gl. Now, if you want this to be equal to simply gm by gl, this whole factor should simply be equal to 1, right? And when do you get that? If you ensure that gx by gs into gm by gl is much, much greater than 1, should be much, much smaller than 1. So now the condition for Gx simply GS into GL by GM. Right? In other words, I could take the inverse of this and write, your Rx has to be much, much greater than GM RL RS. Is that clear? So now if you make sure that your Rx is very, very large, and now we understand how large your Rx should be, then the circuit we have figured out should work as a common source amplifier, right? The same transistor is generating the bias voltage, and the same transistor is also amplifying the required output. Now, the next question, of course, we have to ask is, how do we determine the values of C1 and C2? Right? So we follow the same procedure. We say that C1 is connected between two nodes A and B. Then you calculate what is the Thevenin resistance that is coming between these two nodes A and B, right? Which means you are now able to simplify your circuit as some Thevenin voltage. So this is Thevenin, not threshold voltage, RTH and C1, right? And you simply make sure that the impedance offered by C1 is much, much smaller than the impedance offered by RTH, right? So for this particular case, let us do the calculation for C1. Right. Can you give it a go? So I want you to calculate the limits for C1. So we do this calculation in the incremental circuit. You have RS, VS, then you have the capacitor C1. We simply call the nodes across which it is connected as some A and B. So GM times whatever this node potential is flowing through this. You have resistor RX connected here. And there is a load resistor RL connected here. Okay. Now, of course, we also have a C2 here. Now, you are interested in calculating what is the Thevenin resistance across the nodes A and B. Now, in a calculation like this, where you have two capacitances, and we also know what is the expectation from these two capacitances, we make some smart approximations. So one of the approximation we are going to make is that we'll assume we have already designed C2 such that it is a short at the given frequency, right? So when we are calculating for C1, we will assume that C2 is a short. When we calculate for C2, we will assume that C1 is a short, right? Why is this approximation okay? Because eventually we are going to figure out how large C1 should be, how large C2 should be. Therefore, in the actual circuit, they are anyways going to be short. So while calculating C1, we are taking C2 as a short. Right. Now for calculation of the Thevenin resistance, what do I have to do to the voltage sources? Voltage sources have to be shorted. Right. Then you can see that you have C1 here. You have one capacitor looking to the left side of A. Sorry, one resistor looking to the left side of A. And then you have this huge circuit looking to the right side of B, right? How do we proceed? We can figure out what is the equivalent resistance looking to the right of B, right? So we take this circuit alone first. We figure out what is the resistance looking into that circuit through this node. And then we simply replace this whole circuit with a single value of resistance that we have determined. Okay. So I take this whole portion. Okay. And I now want to calculate what is the impedance looking into this node. right? I want to replace this whole portion with a resistor like this. Let's say some R2, right? How do I determine what is the equivalent resistor value for this circuit? We connect a test voltage, right? You connect a test voltage and you see what is the test current that is being taken from it, right? If I give you a black box and I tell you to calculate its resistance, you are going to apply a voltage across it and measure the current through it, right? The same thing. Is that okay? Now, do you think this can be replaced by a resistor, or is it going to be something much, much more complicated? Will you see capacitors and inductors in that circuit? No, right? You have only resistors and a voltage control current source in that network. So, you should be able to reduce it to a real impedance, which is a resistor. Right? If I solve for Vtest by Itest, you don't expect to see any imaginary terms coming out of it. If there was an imaginary term when you do Vtest by Itest, and you get an imaginary term, that means you could have capacitive or inductive components in it, right? But in this network, because you only have resistors and voltage control current source, you don't expect to get any imaginary terms. You will get only a real term, which means you have an equivalent resistance. Okay? So now, can you quickly tell me what the equivalent resistor would be? So if this voltage is Vtest, the current flowing through the transistor is Gm times Vtest, right? Now, what would this voltage be? What is the current flowing through Rx? It has to be Itest, right? Your Itest is flowing like this, right? Which means this voltage is going to be Vtest minus Itest into R. Then what is the current through this? That will be this potential divided by R, right? And your I test should be equal to the sum of these two currents. Is that okay? So I can directly write the expression for it. Your I test is equal to Gm times V test plus the potential at this node divided by RL. Potential at this node is given by Vtest minus Itest into Rx divided by R, right? So you have no other unknowns in this other than Vtest and Itest. Quickly tell me what is the value for Vtest by Itest. This is Rx plus RL divided by 1 plus Gm times R. Right? So now all that we have done is, in this big circuit, we have replaced everything to the right of node B with a very humble looking resistor of value given by RL plus RX divided by 1 plus GM R. Right? So what is the equivalent resistance appearing between nodes A and B? That will be RS plus RL plus RX divided by 1 plus GM R. So both of them are ground, so you can short it. Therefore, the condition for C1 is, C1 has to be much, much greater than. So what is the condition that we want to enforce? We want to make sure that impedance of the capacitor C1 is much, much smaller than the Thevenin resistance. So this gives you the condition that C1 has to be much, much greater than 1 by omega n into the Thevenin resistance, which is this whole expression now, Rs plus RL plus Rx divided by 1 plus GM R. Is the calculation clear? So we have taken a big incremental circuit that appeared to the right of node A. Then we simply replaced it by its equivalent Thevenin resistance. So that made our circuit much easier to handle. And then we figured out the Thevenin resistance appearing between nodes A and B is simply Rs plus the Thevenin resistance of whatever we calculated on the other side. Right? And then this becomes very easy to determine. Now, once you get an upper limit for C1, you make sure that C1 is at least 10 times larger than this. Right? And then you are guaranteed that for the input signal frequencies you work with, your C1 is going to be short. Right? Now, I want you to repeat the same calculation for C2. Thank you.